Lord. Amen.
Amen.
You're welcome in Jesus' name. Please come and stand up to pray. Father, we just give you thanks. Lord, we honor you. Thank you for the privilege to be in your presence. It's your mercy that brought us. And I know your mercy is going to carry us. We shall be glorified. Your word again, unto you alone shall the gathering be. We declare that this gathering is unto you. I will thank you. We give you praise. Thank you for every life that is here tonight. Father, that even as they stay and go, they will live here with testimonies. In the name of Jesus, we thank you for the life that we are about to celebrate. We thank you for your daughter. And we say your name be glorified. We welcome your very presence in this place. We ask that you chairman this occasion. In the name of God, the Father, the Son, the Holy Ghost, we declare your peace in this place. Be thou exalted. Thank you for everything that is going to be done. We hand it over to you. You see, be extolled in this gathering tonight. For in Jesus' name we are praying.
Just remain standing, if you will. We're going to continue to worship. Thank you so much for being here tonight. Your presence speaks volumes for the family and also to your respect to the deceased. God bless you for coming and sharing this time of prayer and worship and honoring of Mrs. Inyang. And so we appreciate you coming. If you have your bulletin, we have the hymn number one, Amazing Grace. The words will be on the monitors here, the TV monitors, and we're going to have some music. So when the music starts, you can start singing, okay? God bless you. All right.
Oh,
At this time, the scripture reading, Sister Rosalind Moore will be read. Thank you so much.
Scripture reading will be from 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 50 to 58. Now this I say, brethren, that the flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, neither doeth corruption inherit incorruption. Behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump, for the trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. For this corruption must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. So when this corruptible shall have put on incorruption, and this mortal shall have put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, which gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, my beloved brethren, be steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, for as much as you know that your labor is not in vain in the Lord.
Going to be different people? Okay, all right, you come on up.
First of all, thank you all for coming. I have such wonderful memories of my grandmother, especially during my childhood. During most of our school holidays at the time, our parents would drop us off, my siblings and I, at our grandma's for the holiday. During those extended visits, Mama would take such great care of us, and she was always so patient with us. She was so patient that she would answer my endless list of questions. For example, why do people in the village sleep at 7 p.m.? And other random questions. At times, she would just laugh at my questions or say, ask your mother when you see her. During one of my visits, I came to discover something known as crayfish. It's a kind of condiment, like a spice. So my grandmother kept hers in a recycled tin by the fireplace. So I decided this would make a really good bedtime snack. So for some reason, every evening I would sneak up to the kitchen and pour a handful of crayfish and eat it before I go to bed. Anyway, this was not a very exciting development for my grandmother. So she did what any grandmother would do. She came up with a story or something that would stop me from doing that. And she told me, you know, rats like crayfish, you know? And what happens is when you eat it at night and you go to sleep, rats can come to your mouth. That was all I needed. That was it. That was the end of it. No more crayfish at bedtime for me. So besides having such a great sense of humor, my grandmother was a great supporter of my dream to pursue medicine. The funny thing is, before I even told her what my dreams were, she had this talk with me right after I graduated high school. After the advice of stay away from boys, came the part where she said, you know, I'm advising you to become a doctor. That was what she had in plan. Those were her plans for me. She told me she had told my mother to do so, and that didn't pan out, because my mother didn't. So it fell on me to become the first female doctor in the family. And as it turned out, I took her advice after all. wonderful grandmother. She was a very prayerful woman. She helped instill the importance of prayer in my life and in the lives of my siblings. She always expressed so much love and took such great care of us, and at the same time teaching us life lessons. Although I didn't see her much closer to the end, I am glad I did have such great memories of my mother. Thank you.
At this time, the exhortation, the message, and then the prayer for the family will be made by Pastor Jeff Daniels. God bless you.
Praise the Lord.
Forgetfulness. How many of you
have ever had, you know, a horrible thing happen to you and you thought you will never forget it the rest of your life. Give yourself 1 week, you can't remember it anymore. Because God is so amazing that He programmed things so that we can keep on living. And the reason why we keep on living is because there is a mission, there is a purpose to fulfill a life. So it is not enough to know that God has programmed death into life. You need to also understand, why am I living? It's very important. Why am I still alive? Why am I still here? Am I just here to suck up the air? No, there is something that you are here to accomplish. And I want to talk to you tonight briefly from the time that I have. If you have your Bible, go to John chapter 3 and verse 5. John chapter 3 and verse 5. Keep in mind, God programmed death in life. Amen? Doesn't matter how tough you are, one day you won't be that tough anymore. It doesn't matter how mean you are, one day you won't be able to talk anymore. It doesn't matter how hateful you can be, one day you won't be able to hate nobody anymore. It doesn't matter how loving you are, one day you won't be able to love anybody. Keep that in perspective. Is that understandable? John 3 verse 5. Jesus answered what? He was answering the question in verse 4. Nicodemus said unto him, how can a man be born when he is old? Can he enter the second time into his mother's womb and be born? Then Jesus is trying to educate this learned individual about something that is spiritual, that even though he was highly educated in the natural, but this is spiritual matters he couldn't comprehend. And somebody tonight might believe you're going to comprehend something that is very spiritual, that is far beyond your intellect. Hallelujah. It says, Jesus answered, verily, verily, I say unto you, except a man be born of water and of the Spirit, he cannot. Somebody say cannot. He cannot. Somebody say there's no option. It is dangerous these days that God said, Jesus Christ spoke to us in His Word. He says, narrow is the way that leads to life, and broad is the way that leads to destruction. But unfortunately today, preachers or Christians are trying to broaden the way that Jesus said is narrow. He said, the road that leads to life is narrow, but we're trying to make it broad. He didn't say that. If I have 3-bedroom house and apartment, and that is how much I can accommodate in my house, you don't try to force 50 people into my apartment when I just have 3-bedroom. He says, I'm building a mansion, and the mansion I'm building, the road that gets to it is narrow. Why are we trying to deceive people that is broad? By compromising the gospel. We don't compromise the gospel to get people excited, no. He said, narrow is the way, except a man is born again. He cannot, no option, unless a man is born again, he cannot enter into the kingdom of God. That which is born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the Spirit is what? Let's read that again. That which is born of the flesh is what? And that which is born of the Spirit is what? So that which is born of the Spirit doesn't have a spirit, but it's a spirit. Tell your neighbor, I'm a spirit. Don't be scared. Say it like you mean it. I'm a spirit. Somebody's too scared. Say it like you mean it. Say, I'm a spirit. Can you assess, say it to your neighbor, not to yourself. Tell your neighbor, I am a spirit. I'm like, oh my gosh, what happened to you? When did you turn to a spirit? Tell them, I'm a spirit. I'm a spirit. Say that in me, I'm a spirit. Amen. Glory be to God. If you are born again, you are a spirit. You are not just a human being. If you are born again, you are actually not a human being. Your humanity is just a container of your spirit. That is who you are. That is why when someone dies, the same person is still laying there, but they can't talk anymore. Same person, same height, same size,
self-formation, everything, can't talk anymore because that was just a jacket. Hallelujah. And that's why we don't pay too much attention to the jacket. Let's pay attention to the individual. We spend too much money on the jacket. We don't always pay attention to the person that wears the jacket. That is why God's perspective of death must be understood. For seven marvel now that I said unto you, you must be born again. The wind blowing where it listeth, and thou hearest the sound thereof, but cannot tell where it cometh, whether it goeth. So it's everyone that is born of the Spirit. Everyone that is born of the Spirit is just like the wind. Tell your devil, I'm like a wind. You can't predict me. Hallelujah. I'm unpredictable. I'm just like the wind. I am unpredictable. I'm just like the wind. Tell your neighbor, I'm like the wind. My competition is not with my sister. My competition is not with anybody at my workplace. My competition is that I have to be like the wind. The attribute of the wind is what I'm supposed to be like. And since the wind is unstoppable, you are unstoppable. Somebody say, I am unstoppable. The wind is a force to reckon with. The Bible says when you're born again, you are just like the wind. And because the wind is unstoppable, you are unstoppable. That means, according to the word of God, where we just read, it says, the wind goes wherever it wishes, and you can't stop the wind. If the wind wants to go eastbound, there is no building that can stop the wind from going eastbound. If the wind wants to go west, there is no building. There is no tree that can stop the wind from going in that direction. That means you as a child of God, if you are born again, you are alive to fulfill a purpose, and you cannot be scared because of obstacle, because the wind is never intimidated by any obstacle at all. If the wind cannot go through the obstacle, it will go around the obstacle. If the wind cannot go through the obstacle, it can go above the obstacle. If the wind cannot go above the obstacle, it will go beneath the obstacle. If the wind can go below the obstacle, around the obstacle, above the obstacle, the wind will knock the obstacle down. Somebody say amen to that.
Amen.
Do you believe that? You are alive. God has programmed death into life, and you are alive because you are here to fulfill a purpose. Don't live just for living's sake. Hallelujah. And so Jesus Christ said, the condition for you to be like the wind, the condition for you to be a spirit, is that you must be born again. We're going to go back to that at the end of this brief exhortation. But I want you to understand that while you are alive, you need to understand one simple truth, that the spiritual realm is 24/7 alive. The spiritual realm is constantly alive. It's aware of every investment that you make. The spiritual realm is actively alive 24/7. The spiritual realm is actively alive and is aware of every investment that we make. Those are the investments that count at the end of the day, at the end of your life. What are your investments, since the spiritual realm is constantly 24 hours aware of every investment? What investment? Investment of thoughts. Somebody say thoughts. Investment number two is investment of words. Somebody say words. That's the investment of speech. Number three, investment of actions. Somebody say action. So how many investments do we do in life? Number one, thoughts. Number two, speech, talk. Number three, action. You are alive, and your life is valuable to the degree of the investment you make in these areas. Investment of thoughts, investment of speech or talk, and then investment of actions. What investment have you been making in these three areas? Don't forget, the spiritual realm is aware of it. Right now, the spiritual realm is aware of the last thoughts that hit your mind, and it's an investment. Good thoughts, negative thoughts, crazy thoughts, mean thoughts, loving thoughts, the spiritual realm is aware of it. Can you imagine if everybody is conscious of that, how the world would be? That there's nothing actually secret. That God knows my thoughts. God knows what I'm thinking. God knows everything. And I'm going to be recompensed based on those areas of investment. There is nothing that escaped God. Nothing. The law of gravity is 24-hour in active. If you decide, well, it's midnight, nobody's watching, I'm gonna go on top of the roof of my house, God forbid, and just jump, because everybody's sleeping, so I don't think the law of gravity is gonna be active now. Something wrong is gonna happen, don't you think so? Hallelujah. Because laws are constantly active in life. We are alive to invest in these three areas: our thoughts, our speech, and our actions. The actions are just the product of effective process of thoughts and speech. So in order for my actions to be right, because I'm going to be judged based on that at the end of the day, then I have to locate a bank of thoughts that will influence my speech and influence my actions. I have to be very, very conscious of this, because at the end of the day, it is my actions. Although sometimes we want people to judge us by our intentions, and we want to judge other people by their own actions, but you see, that is not fair and it's not right, and that is not how it's supposed to be. All of us are supposed to be judged by our actions. But actions are the byproduct of thoughts. Amen? So if I can fix my thoughts, I will fix my talk, and I will fix my terms or my actions. Let me say that again. If I can fix my thoughts, I can fix my talk, then I can fix my terms, which is my actions. Because you can't start trying to act right if your thought is wrong. You can't act right if your talk is wrong. And so the Word of God is the bank where I feed my mind so that my talk will be right, then my action will be right. But before that happens, I have to be able to expose my life to my Maker and say, I am alive and this is my life. I give it back to you. Use it for your purpose and for your glory, so that at the end of the day, the pastor doesn't have to lie on my funeral. Because that is one of the most difficult moments of most pastors' life, because that is the day you have to say the right things and say things that don't even happen or don't exist. How many of you want to help your pastor out? So, you know, on the day of your funeral, he doesn't have to lie that you were nice, even though you were the most mean person in the church. When you say you're committed, even though you came to church when a prayer was offered. But you see, because someone is dead, the pastor has to say something nice. But can we correct that today? I hope you still love me. Amen? Do you understand that? If we can fix our thought, why do we need that? Because the spiritual realm is aware. It's aware. It's an investment. How much are you investing? I'm talking about the you now, because the one I'm seeing is just a jacket. And that is why the Bible says that we don't have to grieve as unbelievers do. The reason why we don't grieve like unbelievers do is when we don't understand death from God's perspective. Because as far as God is concerned, what dies is not the person that meets him. Do you understand what I'm saying? You see, for instance, this, can I borrow your jacket for a minute? This jacket right here, it doesn't look good the way it is now. Why? Because it loses its shape. It has no shape right now. What gives this jacket shape is when someone wears it. Are you listening to me? What gives this jacket its beauty is when someone puts it on. But the way it is wrapped, it looks rumpled. It doesn't look good. It doesn't matter how beautiful it is. If it's not worn, you can't see the shape of the jacket. Because it was designed to be worn, and that's where you see the beauty of it. The reason why you look nice is not because you're nice. The reason why you look beautiful is not because you're beautiful. It's because of the you that is wearing you. Do you understand that? That is why when someone dies, sometimes they don't look like the person we used to know. Because the real person I've left is just a jacket that we're seeing. Are you listening to me? So who do we invest more on? Invest on the real you. How? With the things of God. Why am I alive? What is my purpose? What am I here for? What am I supposed to be invested in? This is how you feed your mind. And every child of God needs to come to the point where, Lord, you say, Lord, feed my mind with your thoughts. Feed my mind with your wisdom. Feed my mind with your ideas. Feed my mind with your power. Feed my mind with your conscience. Let me operate. The Bible says, his ways are not my ways. His thoughts are not my thoughts. So, if his ways are not my ways, his thoughts are not my ways and my thoughts, and if I'm going to fulfill purpose, then I got to be able to bring my mind into his mouth so he can feed my mind constantly so that my mind is a good investment that will impact on what I say and then consequently impact on my action in life. And that action is what ultimately God is going to say, good and faithful servant. Come on, get some rest over here. Amen. Don't wish to do good. Don't wish to talk good. Wish to think good and act on that. If you can think well, you will talk well and you will act well. But you see, every person is a product of their nature. Everyone is a product of their nature. If your nature has no good in it, there's no way you can do good. Amen? There's no way you can, no matter how sophisticated your dog is, in the nature of the dog, you can't calm the dog down and say, please, this week, I don't want you to bark. Dog, this week, no barking in this yard. All of y'all keep quiet. Just relax. Act like a human being. Yes, man. As you turn your back, it's in the nature. They see a shadow. What's going to happen? Why? It's in the nature of the dog to bark. You don't need to advise a sheep not to bark. It's not in the sheep. Because the nature of the sheep, it cannot, no matter what you do. So in order to influence your action, we have to check your identity. What is your identity? Jesus Christ said to this profound teacher, the lawyer, understood the Bible. For you to be a lawyer or the teacher that Jesus Christ was responding to Nicodemus, for you to become that, according to the law, you would have memorized or actually read, studied, and memorized the five first book of the Bible. I'm not talking about knowing John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son that whosoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. No, that's not what it was. Well, that's not what makes you to be a teacher of the law. For you to be a teacher of the law that Nicodemus was, you ought to have actually effectively studied and memorized the five first book of the Bible without any question. Can you imagine how tough that would have been if that is what would qualify you to be a pastor today? Amen. I'm not talking about you know one chapter of the Bible. No, you know five books of the Bible. You can just bring it out like that. This guy didn't understand the concept of being born again. Being born again, Jesus Christ said, do not attribute my life to the fact that I came from heaven. Attribute my life, what you see in my life, I want you to attribute it to the fact that I am born again. How many of you know that Jesus Christ was born again? Jesus Christ was born again. Amen. He was born again. Amen. Jesus Christ, Nicodemus said, what you are doing is because you came from heaven. Jesus Christ said, no. Anyone who wants to do what I'm doing, they must be born again. And if they're not born again, they cannot enter into the kingdom of God. You see, the kingdom of God is the culture of God. And the culture of God is the mindset that I want each one of us to adopt that as we begin to run out today. Because until you understand that, because inside of us, all of us here, there is nothing black or white or Hispanic or African at all. Nothing. There's nothing. It's just skin pigmentation. Amen? Because right now, I can snatch your heart and fly it to China, and you're going to have your heart working effectively in a Chinese man's body. Do you know that? Yes. So there is nothing black, white, no. The inside is the same. Glory be to God. Except a man is born again, there can be no change. Do you want change in your life? Do you want things to turn around for you? You want to act right? You want to talk right? You have to think right. But as a man thinketh, so is he. And your thinking is predicated on your nature. Who are you? Do you know Jesus? Or do you know church? Do you know Jesus? Or do you know your pastor? Do you know Jesus? Or are you in the choir? Do you have a relationship with Jesus? Or my parents are Christians? Yes, my father is a pastor. I was raised in church for many, many years, but church was not growing in me, although I was growing in church. Do you understand that? I was growing in church, but church was not growing in me. There are many people like that. Growing in church, but church not growing in them. And I always tell people that if I had died before I got saved, there would have been a powerful funeral for the pastor's kid. Wow, the pastor's kid would have been, you know where he would have been. He would have been in hell. And everybody would say, oh, what a wonderful kid he was. Lie. I wasn't wonderful because I used to snuck out of the window in the night and go party, and come back before it was morning, and nobody knew when I was a wonderful kid in the house. But I went to church. I prayed every morning. I prayed every evening. But I wasn't born again. Unless a man is born again, he cannot enter into the kingdom of God. But when he is born again, he becomes a spirit, and he's just like the wind, unstoppable, undeniable. You can accomplish your purpose in life with ease because your example is just like the wind. Since the wind cannot be stopped, you cannot be stopped. The wind cannot be denied, you cannot be denied. The wind goes wherever he desires. You will attain your goal, whatever your goal is, because no one stops the wind. Anyone who dares to stop the wind is at the risk of suffering a wreck. Have you been driving or going somewhere and you found you see this plastic bag struggling because they are hooked on a leaf or the branch of a tree? How many of you have seen this plastic bag? You know what is going on? They are suffering because they are trying to block the wind. Amen? You, when you're born again, nothing should stand on the way. I guarantee you, that plastic bag you see flapping because of the force of the wind, if you go come around in 2 hours, you won't see that plastic bag there anymore. You know why? It couldn't stop the wind. The wind blew it off and continue on this journey. Jesus Christ said, when you are born again, you are just like the wind. Whatever is your dream in life, as a child of God, no obstacle should be able to stop you. And I say to you tonight, whatever I blocked you before and in has come to it in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Do you understand that? No excuses for the child of God. No sicknesses for the child of God. I'm not going to check out until I fulfill my purpose, because God programmed death into life. If there was no sickness, I will still die. No accident, I will still die. Because God programmed it so. So it is not sickness that actually kills a person. It's because God programmed death into life. However we live doesn't matter to God. Because guess what? In the moment, in the twinkle of an eye, those who died in Christ, they shall rise. And the Bible says, I need to pray for my sister and family. And I want us to please get ready. I'm going to ask if there is any pastor, minister, if you're here, pastor, I'd like to ask you to come and join me to as we pray for them. You know, praise God. Put your hands together for the pastor. You know, come and come here. Hallelujah. Thank you so much. Thank you. Amen. Hallelujah. Just come here. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise God. Praise God. Amen. Hallelujah. Glory be to God. Saints, can you stretch your hands towards them as we pray? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. In the name of Jesus Christ. Glory to Shalalos. The God of all comfort. The God of all comfort. Mighty God, Father, we thank you, O God. Thank you for our sister. We thank you, O God, we cover them with the blood of Jesus Christ. We ask, O God, that the power of the Almighty God will prevail in this season of their life. We decree in the name of Jesus Christ. The same way you gave Mama long life, you satisfy her. We pray, oh God, that you will satisfy this month, oh God, in the name of Jesus Christ. We come against premature death. We come against premature death until you are satisfied. In the name of Jesus Christ, you will live, not just being alive, but a life of purpose and focus in the name of Jesus Christ. Father, tonight we come against every agenda of the wicked concerning our lives, even as they prepare to travel, Lord. We ask, O God, for travel messages in the name of Jesus Christ. We pray, Father, everything needed and necessary as it pertains, O God, to the funeral. Let the supernatural hand of God make it happen in the name of Jesus Christ. We ask, O God, that your ability, your resources, the Bible says the cattle of a thousand hills belong to you. We pray, O God, that you make all grace abound towards them in this season in the name of Jesus Christ. I pray for the comfort of the Holy Spirit. Father, reach where no words of man can reach. The Bible says the word of God is quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword. It pierces even to the dividing of soul, of the bones and the marrow and the intents of the heart. Only your word can penetrate beyond the bones. I pray today, Lord, let the words of God that gives comfort penetrate into their core in this season. Give them the comfort that no man can give. Give them the comfort that no man, no institution can give in the mighty name of Jesus. Father, shield them, the entire family, shield them, protect them, keep them together more and more. Let unity abound in this family in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. We frustrate the counsel of the wicked. We activate the counsel of God. We thank you because your word never returns to you void. Father, we are blessing them today with the blessing of divine protection. Be their shepherd as they travel in the mighty name of Jesus. Thank you. We honor you tonight. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. 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 Hallelujah. God bless you. Hallelujah. Amen. Put your hands together for them. Hallelujah. Amen. 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 Hallelujah. Glory be to God. God is a good God. Father, I thank you tonight for this congregation. Thank you for everyone that has come to be a blessing here tonight. I ask, O God, that which we have heard tonight, let it stick to us. Help us to understand and comprehend death from a divine perspective, knowing that the spiritual realm is constantly active and watching our investment of thoughts, investment of speech, and investment of action. Help us to be a people that our action is in line with our nature. We give you praise in Jesus' name. Amen. Put your hands together for Jesus.
Thank you, Pastor Daniels. That great message. Amen. I enjoyed that. That was really good. It did work for God. Amen. It's always good to understand death as a pastor for over 50 years. You know, I just realized that more and more every day, sometimes people don't understand the transformation that takes on by being born again by the Spirit of God. They just don't understand the importance of that. But thank God for the revelation in the Word of God, and we can understand that revelation. Amen. If you would stand with me, and let's sing hymn number 3, It Is Well With My Soul. Okay, God bless you. things will be given and glorious. And let's welcome glorious here. Where shall we do that?
God into your children by naming them some things like that.
But he had to say it about five. I said, please spell that, please. That G-O-P-G-I. Okay, all right. And then he wanted to come in. He was very distraught, very depressed. And then his wife had left him and took his child and took his business. And so he came in, and I developed a good friendship with him now. And so I'm really thankful that I'm able to meet so many beautiful Nigerian people and their culture. And I get to marry them too. I get to perform their ceremony here. And we have ceremonies here, and we boogie all night. You're waiting here. They will dance all night with the weddings. And so, and I think we ought to be able to do that with a funeral. We know where she is now. We know that where mother is. And so we thank God that we can have that spirit of excitement and joy, that we know where she is. Her soul and spirit is with the Lord. And we're so thankful for that. While you're on your way out, I'd like to make a couple of announcements. If you'll notice that there's some food back here in the back. The family members, friends have prepared some food, and it's in containers so that you can take it home. Now, you can eat all of it in the car before you get there, or you can take it home and share it. Either way, we won't tell. Okay? So if you want to eat the whole thing before you get home, that's fine. But if you want to, please take one, and it would be great. And I know we appreciate the family, those who have prepared that for everybody. We thank you so much. And if you'd like to assist the family with an offering, if you have a piece of offering that you would like to give, we have someone over here at that stool over there next to the couch. They'll be positioned over there to receive your gifts if you would like to give something to offset the funeral and things that of this sort. We appreciate so very much the family. If you would like to help in that area, you may do so. We would like to also take pictures after we're dismissed here. I think, Gloria, do you want everybody to be as a group, or do you want them individually, family? Okay. So I'll let Gloria kind of be in charge of that. So once we dismiss, then her and the camera people can kind of take over and assist with that. But I want you to know that we appreciate so very much you being here at Covenant Church. We honor this family, and we appreciate you coming and honoring her tonight. At this time, we're closing prayer by Pastor Ingara.
Let us pray. Father, we just want to thank you this evening because you are a good God. We thank you, Father, for your presence, your abiding presence. You are with us right now, and we have seen you. We have seen your glory. We want to thank you, Father, for this occasion that you have brought us together, not to mourn, O God, but to a glorious event where we remember the life, a life well lived. We thank you, Father, for encouraging us. Father, besides just, even then, we did not come to mourn, but rather we came to be encouraged, and we are living here encouraged. We are not living the same, but we are living this place different, carrying something in our minds, in our spirits. Father, we thank you tonight. We give you glory and honor. We thank you for your comfort, because you keep us in, you keep those whose minds are stayed on you in perfect peace. So we thank you, Father, for keeping our sister Glorious in perfect peace, for keeping her family in perfect peace. In the name of Jesus Christ, even as she travels, we are thanking you for your protection, your angels surround her. Yes, Father, as she travels, thank you for provision. Thank you for providing every need according to your riches in glory in Christ Jesus. Father God, we thank you. For everything is glorious. Everything is beautiful in you. For you make all things beautiful. You reconcile everything, oh God, to beautiful. All things work together for good to those who love the Lord. So Father, even in this occasion that we are gathered, I am praying, oh God, taking this time to agree with each and every person that is in this room. In the name of Jesus Christ, I pray in Jesus' name, yes, Father, for every need, every person who has a need in this room, be it healing, be it financial, be it relational. Yes, Lord, I thank you right now for providing, for taking care of that situation. We are not living the same, but you have provided. Your presence is here. So we thank you, Father, for what you have done. We thank you, Father, for the word that has been preached to remind us, oh God, of the one who gives us shape as we go. Let us remember Jesus Christ, who adorns us and gives us shape in our lives. We thank you and we give you all the glory and honor. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Say something. Star Gloria is gonna dance to her mom's favorite song, and you know, if you brought anything, any gift, just bring it over. You know, something to help, you know, with the funeral, we're just gonna put it in the basket over there. So we're all gonna dance. You know, we're here to celebrate Mama.
Oh, She put that name on you to remind her of that relationship and instill in you that relationship that she had with God, that she would, that you would have that same relationship, a glorious relationship with God. And God bless you. We are honored
for you.
God bless you.
Thank you, Pastor. Right. Thank you so much. Thank you. We appreciate your love. Thank you so much for all the love you've shown. My family will forever and ever be grateful for this honor that you've done us this day. Thank you so much and God bless you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Love you.
Thank you. Love you too. Thank you. Good job.